So I'd like to start with two quotes, which I think very neatly summarize the debate and the conundrum of fiscal policy coordination in Europe. The first quote is, "Each national policy is seeking to solve problems and to overcome difficulties which arise in each individual country, without reference to Europe as an entity. The diagnosis is at national level. Efforts are made at national level. The coordination of national policies is a pious wish which is hardly ever achieved in practice." The second quote, "There is an insufficient appreciation of the essential difference between a customs union, as defined by the Treaty of Rome, and an economic and monetary union." So we've mentioned in the past discussion the Task Force Van Rompuy, the Five Presidents Report, the Four Presidents Report. These quotes are not from this. It's from the 1975 Marjolin Report on monetary integration generally. And this very same report was advocating at the time also the creation of a decision-making center responsible for economic and social policies, able to act by means of a budget of significant size, as well as short and longer term community debt management, which we're still discussing. So I think that not only the diagnosis of the Marjolin report at the time, but also the centralized fiscal instruments advocated are still on the table. And so I'm wondering how it can be that it's been 40 years that we're discussing a real, genuine fiscal union in Europe and have achieved so little in practice. And against that background, I don't think there is a shortage of big ideas. I think that everyone has thrown a lot of ideas on the debate, the most recent one being the European safe bonds, which is now circulating as the latest policy. So what's my point? My point is to say that when talking about fiscal federalism, I think that we should put as much energy, intellectual and physical energy, into the discussion about the optimal allocation of functions and which functional instrument should be performed by whom and how, as we put energy into asking ourselves what would be the useful conditions, the necessary conditions, to allow for such a regime change, because it's a massive, as you outlined, it's a massive regime change. So I see two conditions. The first is obviously that the idea of a supranational fiscal center must be politically accepted. To frame it a bit differently, how do we generate a momentum for this in the current populist context? If you would be a freshly elected and ambitious politician, would this be the first or the last of the policy measures that you advocate if you want to win again the election? And secondly, maybe more deeply, what is the cultural acceptance condition, let's say, of a fiscal union? And how would you frame then the message to European citizens? What's exactly the narrative? How do you want to convince them? Would it be by using alarmist calls, as we use when we say if the euro fails, Europe fails, will that work again? Or what would be the cultural link there? My sense that it's the right message would be more framed according to federalism, because in fiscal federalism, there is federalism. Maybe we look a bit too much at the fiscal side and say that federalism is really a big change, would be a big change in Europe, and that would affect European citizens, and that we would have to explain first how positively and through which channels they would be positively affected. So I don't want to be too long, because part of my job is to stick to timing. So we'll stop here. You might have a chance to come back to this in your interventions, also Jonathan, that would be great. But we have around 6 or 7 minutes per participant. And I will give you a bad look after 6 minutes, because my job is also to bring you, to bridge you until the Prosecco, which will be served at 7 or 7:15 probably. Okay. Shall we start maybe with Philippe Van Parijs, if you don't mind?
I would prefer, as a philosopher, I prefer to speak again.
Okay, let's give the final word to the philosopher. So I'll try with the other Philippe. Philippe Genschel, if you don't mind starting.
Well, yes, I have to admit, I haven't prepared such a well-set talk as Jonathan. I just have four very short observations listening to the debate. You know, the first observation is on policy dilemmas. The problems of monetary union and the reason why we seem to discuss fiscal union still after 40 years is that there's a policy dilemma. Policies that would work, you know, progressive income taxes, that Elisha's classic fiscal federalism or Waltraud's monetary, fiscal and financial union, these are politically not viable or politically naive. On the other hand, policies that might be politically viable don't work. So the surveillance model and frankly also the Brazilian fiscal responsibility law, this example did not strike me as a particularly convincing example of a case where fiscal regulation really contained fiscal exuberance. You know, you had the law, you know, I just listened to your talk, you had the law, it worked for 7 or 8 years through fair weather conditions, then you had a couple of exogenous shocks and compliance went out of the window. The second observation is on comparative perspectives. Perhaps, you know, our debate suffers from a wrong level of aspiration. Wrong aspirations with regard to the speed of the transition to fiscal union. So as Waltraud's paper details in entertaining detail, it took the US between 150 and 200 years to develop a full fiscal union, and it was not a smooth process at all. So why should we expect a smooth project in Europe? Also, it was not an orderly process in the sense that people discussed, you know, consistent blueprints, but it was muddling through. Therefore, I'm not sure if muddling through is such a terrible perspective for Europe. It's just the standard operating procedure of politics. And also maybe the aspiration level is set at the wrong level substantively, because as we just heard in Jonathan's talk, even fiscal unions do not always produce all the nice things in terms of insurance and redistribution that we usually assume they do. Third observation on political constraints. Of course, there is an obvious constraining consensus. Of course, there's this new cleavage between, you know, however you call them, cosmopolitans and nationalists, urbanites and rural areas, and this makes intergovernmental agreement difficult in a very obvious sense. But at the same time, you know, ironically, I feel that Brexit has proved that something like a European identity exists, because, you know, the emotional energy that went into the Brexit discussions, not only in Britain, but also in Europe, would not be explainable if only interests were involved and not emotions and identity. So I think there is a growing there is a growing recognition also among mass publics that somehow you hang together with other mass publics. Of course, this is uncomfortable, especially during crisis, and it's also quite obvious how this could lead or facilitate disintegration, but you know, it may also be the first step towards more integration. I would say, you know, let's see in 50 years. A final observation on Pierre's question, cultural acceptance conditions for fiscal union. And, you know, let me just tell an anecdote, a very personal anecdote about German unification. When German unification came, I was in my mid-20s. I thought, you know, these guys are not us. You know, why don't we unify with Denmark or somebody I know? Why do we have to unify with them and pay for them? You know, I thought this was, you know, can we have a referendum on this? Of course we could not. The government said the issue was settled 50 years ago. You know, you pay for them. And then, you know, you started to pay and, you know, the act of paying created the solidarity that was required to sustain it. So, you know, the question is, how do you do this leap? Okay, and on this happy note, I close.
Thank you very much, Philip. Also for the example on German reunification. Stefan, if you don't mind following up, you can also give your feeling on German experience.
Exactly, and therefore, I think I have at least one more minute. Somehow, I had a completely different feeling. I was in my mid-20s as well, mid-20s basically as well. I always thought that the split was highly unfair, because if you look at the regions in Germany which had voted most National Socialist, they were in the West and in the South mainly. And Prussia was the one which had least voted National Socialist. Therefore, I always found it extremely unfair that these parts had to suffer much, much more, and they still suffer to a certain extent. And that was the reason why, among three universities which gave me an offer to in the West, one in the East, I said, I go to Halle in the East. Just because I thought that that was a huge task somehow of fairness, not so much of... I have three ideas which I really liked today. The one I knew already, that you should think a little bit more about the advantages of decentralized decision taking. And the other two were by Waltraud and Jonathan, and I came to them. Basically, what I would like to have as a summary of this afternoon, for me at least, I think is that with respect to how to allocate decision-taking power, you should just differentiate between financial and banking part, where a lot of centralized decision-taking makes a lot of sense, whereas for fiscal integration, I think that there are much less reasons really to push so much for it. Why do I think that? The second interesting thing for me was basically that Waltraud told us that somehow banking crisis trigger the other crisis mostly. There's one exception, Greece, but do we want to construct basically the scheme of how the EU should evolve from one original sin, basically? You realized Greece should not have been accepted in the Eurozone. It was a mistake. It was a political mistake. But just because you have that, should you construct basically the scheme of how Europe should develop on that simple mistake? I totally agree that now there should be solidarity with Greece, but we shouldn't construct from one example which went wrong the whole perspective of the future. Now, I liked that very much, even though I was not completely sure whether basically the idea was that banking crisis or banking problems are the cause, or rather are only a symptom or somehow, but I had the feeling that without banking crisis, you don't have very easily the other crisis, and that is true for all the other countries. Now, if that is so, then if we think of stability, which is really a common value, and which we cannot disintegrate, we need it altogether in Europe, then, of course, one has to think of the best scheme of banking supervision, and it's clear that the competition between supervisors was one of the major causes of the banking crisis in Europe. They had participated to some extent as well in the securitization, but basically they were on the investment side. And there, some supervisors, included the German supervisor, didn't do a good job because they wanted to be fancy and to compete with the others. And therefore, I think that that mixture in the European Banking Union somehow of centralizing and at the same time having a differentiated supervisory bodies which know the local, but at the same time are no longer subject to regulatory capture, is a good idea. I agree that quite a few things, like for instance, the own funds requirements are perhaps still a bit too low. We could still learn incrementally in various respects with this deposit guarantees from the US. I agree on that, but my main message is here I think that the centralization or the degree of centralization which took place makes really sense. I want to add one thing. I think that in banking law, one should think not only about the supervisory scheme and the deposit scheme, but actually what triggered the financial crisis was basically a problem of contract law, of capital market law, and so on. You had you didn't have a good regime in lending. You didn't have a good regime in securitization. So one should think not only about the banks at the end, but somehow about those transactions as well, a more robust, a more fair, to a certain extent, banking contract law. Now, why do I think, and that is my second point, why do I think that on the fiscal side, it's not really the same, it's not the same issue? I totally take your point, and that was the third thing I really liked, that you say, well, if we can't have the first best, we take the second best, and somehow it's feasible to have a banking union, it's not really feasible to have a fiscal union in Europe. Perhaps in 50 years, but I would even go further. I'm not so sure whether it's only a second best. It might be, we don't discuss, you said it might be a second best, and I would say yes, we should really discuss much more what a fiscal union would imply. It would imply that basically on redistribution issues, on social security issues, on healthcare issues, we no longer want to have rather different preferences in Europe, and because that is the big advantage somehow of a decentralized decision taking. And we should discuss that first, whether we really want that. I personally, because I have many children, I like the Italian system or the Greek system, the southern system still with a more somehow family responsibility. But it wouldn't work necessarily in all countries. And I think that in Italy and also in Greece, there were a lot of problems somehow with the crisis, but they still suffered less because of those family ties, which they still have much more. Now, I think we first have to really to discuss whether we want to align the preferences in these core areas of redistribution or whether we do not want to, and I'm not so sure what the outcome will be. That is more a question of really discussing that first than the fiscal union, which is necessary. Mm-hmm. In my view, it's not necessary for stability purposes. It would be necessary, perhaps, if one wants to unify the preferences.
Thanks.
Now, my last idea on that is that does not include that there shouldn't be solidarity in moments of crisis, and I see the Greek bailout as one which first helped the bank, completely sure. But now the bank loans, typically at 5, 6, 8%, and now probably at 10%, were replaced by ESM, basically ESM or other other credits given to Greece at an interest rate typically of 1 or 2 or 3%. That in the second, I think that is discussed much too little, that in the second round, the part of solidarity is rather big. Now it's just between market price, and if you count that for 10, 20 years, between market price of interest and the interest rates really charged, there lies really the solidarity. Again, one could discuss whether one wants more or not. Perhaps it's a balance somehow between, on the one hand, keeping the incentives intact, and on the other hand, having some solidarity at least. That, I think, for the moment being, is a principled approach, not only a modeling through, that you should keep both somehow in mind if you propose solutions.
Thank you, Stefan. We might come back to many of the things you just said. Ramon?
Migration crisis, what the union can do and what cannot do, what can expect from it and what cannot be expected from it. And what this is a constant confusion. The inability to, because when we talk about different dimensions of fiscal union, to what I will refer, is the inability many times to make clear what is expected and what can be delivered. And then that had to happen in any federal state, but it's certainly in the union it's been fairly confusing. In particular, because then this creates the very easy thing that be demagogic. It's always Brussels' fault, always about anyone else's fault, but not me. And this fact has been behind the situation with the UK and the Union. So I think that the last slides are very enlightening also about what, and I have surely shared with you that many things that are out there, they're not very realistic, so maybe you shouldn't spend a lot of time on them. If we think of Union, I think there are several dimensions. And that's another thing, let's not talk about whether fiscal union or not. There is a lot of fiscal union already. And the question is just to be clear of what we have and we have not. One certainly is the fiscal rules aspect of it. And I agree with you that it's not very credible that you're gonna use the stick. So then let's be creative about what is the carrot. But although I disagree with you that we don't have carrots, we do have a lot of carrots already, and the question is whether we can develop more. A second element is on reshaping. And I think that was very revealing also, the data about the lack of reshaping in many. But one can think about, and that's something we work in the project, is about mechanisms of resharing that we'll take into account both things, that there is no unwanted redistribution, and there is some element of moral hazard taken into account. Well, we have two projects. One is to do it like across countries. And as a way to do it, as opposed to using sovereign debt, which is what we use now, okay, to smooth things. And you can see gains. How can we implement that? That's something we'll have to work more. But that's not that far from what ESM is doing now, which is putting the debt in long term with some conditions. The question is doing it properly and not just using it as the last resource. So what is bad of having mechanisms which only act at the moment of crisis, that they don't build up trust? Because at the moment it acts, it's like you're in the intensive care unit. That's not the time that you create good behavior on anyone. So if we think of any mechanism, we should think of a mechanism that it works in an everyday life. And in a sense, it can be voluntary. We also look at the same issue when we think about, because part of the discussion is whether you should do this in the for an employment issues, and that becomes much more complicated. For one reason, because the labor markets are very different. So you might have to be very careful. So it sounds very good, but in the sense that it builds up more social Europe and everyone will see some merit, we have to be extremely careful how you do anything like that. But then, there are elements that I think that are certainly here, which is the need of a fiscal backup, both for the banking union and for the ECB. The ECB now is doing things that, okay, it's doing very successful, but also those are the carrots. And the ECB has been doing that because has not decided not to buy some debts or not. And this is a huge carrot.
That's a very big carrot, yes.
Okay. The only problem is how to instrument this. I also mentioned before that maybe a place that people can start understanding that we have a little more fiscal capacities because we understand that we definitely want some global public goods managed better, like defense and other things. And maybe that's the way that people, some fiscal capacity will have to come back because it's difficult that we do it just by passing the way that now the budget is built. But that is around the corner. A lot of discussion, of course, is about whether you have to avoid some fiscal tax competition, which is close to the competition on the regulators, but it's on the fiscal side. There's a new proposal of the Commission to do that. None of those have gone very far. But on the other hand, something, particularly on the case of corporate taxes, will have to happen. Will have to. Of course, of all these things, then the question is how you put them together. And that's not that trivial, because part of the games is precisely what you do, like we have the SM there and the other thing there. But first of all, legally, that's not very consistent. So that's one aspect, how you put things legally consistent. And nowadays, the Eurogroup, which is using a major role, is not, has no legal status, basically. So we still have the lawyers to work. Quite more to work, more we have discussions on this. But the other is also the political aspect. Because in as much that the ECB is a carrot, some of these elements are this, well, that becomes fairly political. And that doesn't look like the Eurogroup or the Council is the best place to do these things. So I think that that's a problem we have. There is one last thing I wanted to mention that has not come out at all, which is this issue. Okay, you say, well, we don't have enough federations, there is no surveillance, there is not so much of looking at each other. But maybe it's not so bad that we have this transparency in the following sense. I look at, for example, that we have a similar version of all these things now in Spain, of course, because we have again discussing what we're going to do, we have a new constitution and all these things. What problem is that has created a lot of problems there is not only maybe how you do some rules that you were saying before and whether the rules then through the bargaining process, it's also about the transparency. If it turns out that the Minister of Economy is the guy who controls the data and information and comes up at the end of the year and says, okay, now the regions get more, the other regions not, and this, well, that doesn't build any trust whatsoever. So any system that builds trust has to have some way of transparency. And well, now we have supposedly these independent fiscal authorities or something, which have a very different role in different countries. But I think those elements are important. That because to think, and on that I will sort of cannot take it from the Brazilian case. I mean, we're not going to have a central guy in Europe. We are not going to be there. Probably we don't want to be there in any case. It is a very simple thing. If you think, okay, well, I'm critical of the way we have the executive call the council because the guys are voted for their guidance, not to about thinking about Europe. So push us in favor of having more of a president or something which counterbalances. Okay, that's fine. But if you think ran the last US election in Europe with some states voting in a radical different way, that's it. That's the last year we have this election. I mean, so we have, so that's out of the picture. Then Nestle has to be a way that then we have some transparency and accountability of these things.
Thank you, Alma. Okay.
Really greatly enjoyed Jonathan's very rich, quickly delivered exposition, debunking common illusions and making intriguing conjectures. But I strongly disagree with the way he started. He started by saying the first question to ask is a question of political feasibility. No, that's the last question to ask. First, you must ask what you want. And what you want must be feasible economically, it must be economically sound, it must be ecologically sustainable, it must be socio-psychologically sustainable. And then you must turn to the question of political feasibility, which is important. And what you think is good and sustainable in all these ways, you'll make it politically feasible. That's the way you should go about these things. More specifically, you have, Alicia and yourself, you had these two options very explicitly in Alicia's presentation, and sort of it came again and again in your presentation. In Alicia's case, it was between, on the one hand, the surveillance option and the classic fiscal federalism option. She discussed the two. She said classic fiscal federalism is a big problem, democratic deficit and all that. Turned to the other one. She said it's easier because you can go to it gradually. But in the end, it would be worse than the fiscal federalism. In your case, in fact, what you considered was the transfer, what you call the transfer option, meaning transfers to states or between states, and Finanzausgleich and all that. On the one hand, and the other form is interpersonal redistribution. You summarize your view on that at the very end by saying, would Florida be Greece without transfers between states? You said, no, bullshit. That doesn't have any influence. Then you ask, would Florida be Greece without the interpersonal transfers that operate through the federal welfare state? And then you said, yes, that it would be in big trouble in all likelihood because of all sort of vicious circles and sort of that set in, and as that did in a number of European countries, not only in Greece. Okay, so, but you said at the same time, look, unfortunately, what we managed to do, Americans, you won't be able to do it in Europe. It's politically unfeasible. Now, we helped you do it because the war you benefited from and that made it possible, we did. So now that you have a somewhat bellicose president, maybe you can do something for us. So, but there may be sort of safer and less risky ways of getting there, and that's my point. Number three, which is that these interpersonal transfers, we may need them for the reason that has been discussed all along, namely as a macroeconomic stabilizer. But there are other reasons why they are important. A second reason, and I come now to a connection with Brazil, a second reason is as a demographic
stabilize. That is, if we want to make Schengen politically sustainable, we need something like that. I remember going to visit, I had an audience with President Fernando Henrique Cardoso in the 1990s. At a moment when there were a number of experiments of under the name of Bolsa Escolar in a number of localities, the federal district of Brasilia, city of Campinas, a sort of means-tested minimum income scheme in a number of places. But this couldn't spread to poorer municipalities without the help of the federal state. And so there were relatively rich municipalities that could afford it. So I went to see Cardoso with my friend, San Paulo Senator Eduardo Suplicy, ex-senator now. And one of the arguments, we had a long discussion with Cardoso, and he said, and one of the arguments that helped convince, don't know to what extent, the president at the time to have a federal co-funding of these local schemes was the demographic stabilizer. If you wanted to prevent all the negative externalities related to the flocking of all these people coming from the Nordeste and flocking into the favelas of Rio, São Paulo, and a number of other cities, you needed to have some sort of social protection that would spread also to the poorer municipalities. Well, if you don't want to have the sort of backlash you have in a number of our bigger cities, in richer cities in Western Europe, because of all these Bulgarian, Romanians. I learned yesterday from Carlos that Romanians are the third nationality in Spain. So the number, it's the second nationality in one of the Brussels communes, where there are create a real problem of integration. If you don't want to have the backlash, in political backlash in our cities, in those places, well, you need to enable people and to stay close if they don't have a strong reason. You don't need to shut and Schengen, but you need to prevent, to enable people to stay, to do what they would prefer to do, stay closer to their roots, to their elderly parents, for some of them, and that would help make Schengen sustainable. So it's not only a question of macroeconomic stabilizer, it's a question of demographic stabilizer, but it's not all. So I, in my Max Weber lecture, I referred to this stunning text by Friedrich Hayek, published in 1939, arguing for something like the European Union on the very plausible double ground that on the one hand, the common market would disable the various welfare states, would make the various national states unable to do the redistributive and regulatory jobs which they had been performing in the past, while at the same time, the union itself would be too heterogeneous to take over these tasks. Well, in order to re-enable these welfare states, in order to preserve their generosity and their diversity, you need to fit under them something that will help them face better the pressure of tax competition and of social competition. Now, of course, doing that at the European level is precisely what Hayek said was impossible, would be politically unfeasible, but it's not because he said that it's impossible that we shouldn't do it, especially as 10 years later, just after the Second World War, he published another article, Socialism and the Intellectuals, which he also briefly quoted, in which he says, look, situation is desperate here after the Second World War in Europe and in North America. Socialism is winning all over the place. You have the New Deal, you have the Eastern countries that are becoming socialists. In Western Europe, you have the growth of some nationalizations and the growth of the welfare state all over the place. What explained that? It was the fact that socialists were bold enough to defend the socialist utopia and thereby to make politically feasible what would otherwise would not, never have become politically feasible. What we need today, said, is a liberal utopia, and that is actually what happened. We wouldn't be in a neoliberal world if there hadn't been people like Hayek to say what we need to do is not just submit to the politically feasible, but shape the politically feasible by having a utopia and defending ideas, with possibly with this sort of arguments. And I finish, and that's my fourth point, which is my Bismarckian point about that. So allow a Belgian next to my two German colleagues to make this point, which is that a fourth reason for having it, for having something like interpersonal redistribution, is also the reason why, or connected to the reason why Bismarck introduced something that was far more utopian than interpersonal redistribution at the European level, which was the first ever social security system created at the level of a whole state. And he did that, in part, no doubt, because this is what would help him unify Germany, which until then had been a set of separate duchies and principalities whatever. So you created this sort of connection. So if today we ever want the European Union to be legitimate, not only in the eyes of the movers, people who are sitting in the room here and all of us here, people who benefit, or some of the people you described, the urban ones, and so, but also in the eyes of the majority of the stay-at-homes, the people who feel neglected, forgotten, etc., and are happy to finally find a Trump or a Farage who has understood them. If we want that, well, we need to make the benefits of the European Union far more tangible to them, just as Bismarck, with his pension system, made it far more tangible to the bulk, at least, of the formerly working population at the time. Of course, Bismarck didn't do that out of the kindness of his heart. He did it also because there was a pressure from the working movement at the time. And so what we need to do to make it politically feasible is not just to have ID, but struggle for it. And so all these young people in this institute should be among the people thinking and at the same acting to make it politically feasible. So please, when you think about these issues, don't follow Jonathan's advice. Don't start with political feasibility. Finish with it and, of course, think about it, because all the things he said are extremely important, but they must be thought about as at the point of the strategy we need to use. In this place, we need to be Machiavellian, and intelligently Machiavellian, with the sort of analysis which Jonathan has provided, not only in this talk, but also in his previous work.
Thanks a lot, Philippe. So I will give a chance to Jonathan also to react to what has been said. But before, I just wanted to pick a bit the audience, so I can see there. Yes, afterwards, yes, sure they will. But you talked already, you just talked, so. You can see the number of hands raised. I'm going to do a first round of four, privileging people who didn't speak yet. So I'll start with Laszlo, Carlos, Tomasz, and that was the first round. So.
I like the Philip's comments about this, what is viable is not realistic, what is realistic not viable. I think that perhaps, just in the spirit of the presentation of Alicia, perhaps what you suggested is muddling through might be perhaps realistic, but might not work. In the sense that in the framework of this confederal system or this or intergovernmental system, yes, where accountability is only national, yeah, it's very hard to imagine. I have to be short. Very hard to imagine to move towards fiscal federalism in a muddling through way. Yeah, more likely is disintegration. Just briefly, we are in a situation in which every domestic act, be it election or referendum, seems to signal the last day of EU or EMU, or it signals some danger, something endangering. So in this system where there is no European representation, there is no direct election of either legislative or the executive, it's very hard to imagine a gradual or evolutionary move towards fiscal federalism. That's just to provoke you. Question to Alicia. What could be a theoretical argument to leave out the non-EMU members from any kind of federalism. Wouldn't it be that, for example, the argument that you mentioned, for example, the structural asymmetries or asymmetric shocks, not apply for countries like Romania, Bulgaria, Hungary, Poland, and things like that? They were mentioned, actually, this kind of possibilities in the Agenda 2000. So my question is there any kind of strong theoretical argument to think, link federalism with monetary integration and not with market integration? And in general, yeah?
May I just suggest, because you had one comment and one question, and I want to involve also the panelists, so I would suggest that that Alicia comments your question or answers your question during the drinks, so that Carlos can speak, Tomas can ask his question, and we move on.
Thank you very much. My name is Carlos Closer from the Schumann Center. And I have a question for Stefan Grundmann, but the question goes beyond, and I would like to put on the spot perhaps something that has been neglected in the discussion. But I understand you, and as a kind of alibi to put this issue on the table. You were arguing in favor of this model of discussing first preferences, and you were referring in a kind of, for me, a very kind of dubious way to certain preferences, like the preference for the so-called Southern European welfare model, which is not really a preference. You could argue that some parents prefer grandparents to have taking care of kids, but it's not really a preference. It's a kind of factual description of reality. But my question is not that. The question is that the discussion of preferences has to be done in the European context on the basis of asymmetry of power. And that is totally absent of the discussion. It is not the same to discuss on the basis of a strong macroeconomic and fiscal position that on the basis of a very weak one. And it's the kind of debate we are having now in the European Union. When we were speaking before about the importance of democratic inputs in this process, we are neglecting the importance of power that Jonathan was very clearly outlining in the structure of the fiscal federalism in the United States. The power of the states condition very much the results. In this situation, I don't think that there is a kind of meaningful debate in terms of preference between countries that have a specific position and countries that have a very different situation. Someone was speaking before about competition between different policy options, and I wonder, what kind of competition can you have in terms of labor market reform, which is not a European Union competence, we know it's a national competence, when the biggest country or the country with the biggest labor market assumes a reform of the labor market in certain conditions that externalizes the consequences to the other countries? You are not speaking really about symmetry. We're speaking about something different. And I think this use of power should be put on the table in this discussion. It's left out, and I don't know why.
Okay, Thomas, short question, please.
I have a short question about political feasibility, because I think we all agree that, regardless what you said, that maybe muddling through would be in fact better, it's a part of politics and it's not that terrible. I think we all agree that some kind of fiscal union is advisable, either as an insurance mechanism or as a way to provide public goods, as Ramon mentioned, or as a fiscal backstop of merely banking union, right? There has to be bigger budget at the EU level. And in the discussions on the political feasibility of this idea, I always hear one like killing argument. Germany will never agree on that, right? So there is no way to overcome these issue of redistribution. Germany will not pay for Greeks, right? And many presentations touch upon the U.S. experience, both Voltrod and Jonathan, on how the U.S. Fiscal union came about and how they dealt with this issue. And in fact, the first fiscal bill of the first U.S. Congress was not to help the states. It was to provide U.S. public goods. It was even before the Madison introduced this bill in May in 1789, even before Hamilton was appointed as the Secretary of Treasury. So it was not to bail out the states, it was not a way to assume the debt of the states, but to provide common good, which was security issues and as the U.S. Constitution says, common security for all of the states. So my question is, how this mechanism of fiscal union, whatever it is, and by fiscal union I mean fiscal union as in the classical fiscal federalism sense, with the EU tax power and EU large budget. What do we have to do to convince Germany that such a system is advisable, and how it can be projected so we are able to implement it? Because in the US case, just to come back to the US and how US fiscal union came about, during this confederation period before the constitution, there were two proposals to grant the confederal Congress power to tax, and there was always one state who vetoed this proposal. First Rhode Island and then New York. Why? Because they were benefiting from customs duties, from tariffs. The New York state budget was, two-thirds of the budget was customs, and abandoning this revenue was a huge loss for New York. So obviously it was opposing, and for the ratification convention, anti-federalist won majority of the votes. But it was probably a genius of Alexander Hamilton, so he was able to convince New Yorkers to agree on the Constitution. And one of the main arguments he used, and apparently it was he was successful in this, was joining the fiscal power with the future expenditure. So on which purpose this US fiscal union, fiscal federal power to tax will be spent? So US public good, which was security. New York at the same time was most exposed to the foreign invasion, and it was forecasted that it will benefit the most from having a fiscal union. So even though it was paying the most, it was expected to benefit most. So my question is, maybe in the for the EU to make it feasible, maybe as Ramon also suggested, maybe a good way to do it is to connect EU fiscal union not only to Germans paying for Greek in the times of crisis, but to connect fiscal union with the European public goods, like dealing with migration, dealing with borders, and etc. But it's the question to you. Thank you.
Okay. So before I give a chance to the panelists to engage with those comments and questions, Roland, how much time do we have left? 10 minutes. 10 minutes. Okay. So let's try to be disciplined. About 10 minutes. So Jonathan, if you could react to the questions raised. We can pick up what you want. You have the privilege, but also to what has been said before, and then we will move from Ramon to Philippe, if you agree.
I'll try to agree. You know, second and third best alternatives seem pretty good to me right now. So I feel the anger that is out there that is directed toward the cosmopolitan elite in the United States is very real, and it's much strong. I knew it was there, but it was much stronger and nastier than I ever imagined. And perhaps Europe is not that way, but you know the Machiavellian goals of centralizers are the moment is, it seems to me that it is not. I mean, it is. I think it is a marathon and not a sprint. At this moment, to try to push, especially, I was really referring more to the kind of hierarchical monitoring kind of approach, less than the fiscal union. Those are the kinds of things that I think, if pushed too hard at the wrong time, could be the end of the whole project. And that's what I. But I mean, again, as an outsider, it doesn't really just. Unfortunately, not here often enough to really feel like I understand, and I can take other people's views on this more seriously than my own. But it seems like pushing too hard on the wrong buttons in terms of centralization could be disastrous. And on this, you know, this question of that I started this my book with years ago about what are the ways of creating fiscal discipline in a union? I still believe there are basically two ways: one through hierarchy, and one through markets. And the kind of hybrid that has been attempted in the European Monetary Union seems to me not to have worked, and it seems that hierarchy is not the solution. So finding some way to return, even though the terminology is one that people don't like, you know, I mean, Tavolini says, you know, I've had enough of market discipline. That just means Italy can't borrow during a crisis. That's what kind of what use is that? And I understand very well. But it seems that if the structures are in place, and that there's some kind of good understanding of what will happen in the event of the next fiscal crisis, and there's a kind of a procedure that I think in the banking sector and the fiscal kind of is brought together, and that everyone understands what that process looks like, it can lead to something like market discipline for member states. And whether that's a second best option or whether we think it's a first best option, I don't know. But I do feel that in the short term, it seems to be the only option. And I think I share your idea about where the long term goal should be. But maybe the Machiavellian strategy is to be very careful at this moment about what we try to do. You mentioned Bismarck and pensions. I think in the history of pensions, again, war they start with pensions for soldiers in many cases. I don't know if the Bismarck started that way, but in many other settings, when we look at the history of pension policy, it starts with returning soldiers. And then the mention of public goods, it does seem kind of possible that. In the U.S. context, it was fear of attack by the British. That was what caused the fiscal union to take place. And so having some sense of what those collective goods are, that does certainly seem important. They do seem historically important. They have a lot to do with protection against outside invasion. But that doesn't mean that's the answer. We need to not get too hung up on history and imagine that just because it happened this way in these other cases, it has to this way here, and I didn't mean to present that either. I'm sorry if I was too pessimistic. it is hopefully just a phase that some of us are going through right now.
Thank you.
It is that let's be careful because in Europe, there is so much rhetoric about what we want that creates a lot of frustration everywhere. So I think that, and I also agree with the point of avoiding the moratic stabilization, and as we have lived through that, okay, on the problem. So these issues are there. But this sort of calls for some minimum level that everyone should have, and then how do we guarantee that this happens in the different states, and then from then on. A similar version happens for us in Spain. Now we think about how we restructure things. You have to put some levels that people, it has even to do with mobility, both things. On one hand, mobility, and the other hand, well, exactly, because it's mobility, you don't avoid that some regions or some countries completely disappear. This happens even with the research policy. We don't want like three big centers of super excellence, one in Stockholm and the other place, and the rest not doing anything. So all these things have to manage these issues. I think that's an aspect. And the question is how we do it without overdoing it in a way that it will backlash. Because populism is also there, okay? I mean, you were saying about the United States, with people moving too much United States as an example. Now it's not even saying, look at what they have in the United States, we're the same. No, people don't say that. So I think that was true, and it's also true what Carlos said, that maybe we should talk a little more about spillovers.
To answer Tomas' question, you know, how do we convince Germany? And of course, the way to convince Germany is to convince the German public and the German government that this is somehow in the German interest to delegate fiscal power to the European level. Of course, a war may help, or the threat of war may help, which is a rather drastic scope condition. But, you know, Kindleberger has a theory of benevolent hegemony where the hegemon, under less threatening conditions, you know, economic crisis may be enough, may, you know, identify the national interest with, you know, the collective interests of a larger group. Now, the question is, why hasn't this happened during the Eurozone crisis? And some observers said it should have happened. But, you know, I think that there are some historic and, I'm afraid to say, cultural reasons to explain why Germany is so hesitant to lead and hesitant to assume that what's best for itself is also best for a larger group. And this may quite perversely stand in the way. On muddling through, Laszlo is, of course, right. You can't muddle through your way to the classical fiscal federalist structure, but you may muddle your way through to quite a lot of risk sharing and redistribution. And in Waltraud's work, there are lots of examples about target and all the emergency funds, OMT, banking union. And of course, you know, there are good reasons to think that these structures are perhaps not ideal in very many respects, but they provide some risk sharing and also some redistribution, and maybe it may be sufficient to keep the union together for now, to prepare the ground for the utopia that may come later. No, I'm an optimist as well.
So before we give the last word to Philippe as a utopian, Stefan, if you want to step in.
Now, one question was really directed directly to me, but somehow the overall framework, I think I'm closest to Ramon, really. Somehow a bit of utopia is good, but a bit of somehow the constraints is good as well. And the examples were basically Hayek said communism had a bigger idea. In the long run, I don't know whether that is an example we should all strive for. Bismarck's reform, at that age, the average life expectancy was at 45. It was set at 65, and 3% of the population reached 65. So it was basically a pension for invalids of war.
And for the widows. The widows
got it only quite a bit later. That is, Bismarck introduced it at 65, and it's still at 65, only that it's different now. Utopia is always a problem somehow. We define it differently. Different people define it differently. And with that, I'm somehow at the preferences again. I said there are several reasons for decentralized decision taking or policies. Preferences is one. The other one is experimentation, discovery device. Now, if we take the three major transfer questions or social questions, I would say it's health insurance, it's social security pensions, and it's labor. And I would say we have the possibility to have a full insurance like in Germany. We pay 16% for the health insurance, or we say we want 5%, basically as is as exists as well. And everybody has to care for his health up to basically half a salary of a month. Saying basically it's like a car. I invest in that, I pay only 5%, not 16% of my income. I think these are large differences, and each I could imagine that each country or each region might want to decide on that differently. Now, with respect to old age, it's basically in Southern Europe, in Italy, you have home ownership of above 60%. In Greece, even more. In Germany, you have it below 30%. It's different models, basically, income-based or somehow real estate-based. I think that makes a huge difference how you shape your old age. And as I said, I'm more Italian than German in that. I would prefer in both kinds. I mean, the minority in Germany. I would prefer the other model. The same is with labor law. Basically, Germany doesn't have any unemployment any longer because it has the largest low income segment. It's basically the idea everybody should work. And we do our social system basically in that way, whereas other countries don't have that model. I think it's still a question one can really discuss, and I think that given the societies we have, the polities we have, those who speak with each other, I think the discussion forum now is still more regional than the 350 billion.
Thank you. So I think we have many things also to discuss during the drinks, but if we could have just your last word.
Yeah. One, I think in our personal lives and in our collective lives, it's essential to constantly be on the lookout to turn setbacks into opportunities. And that's what the New Deal did after the wars. But even when things are not as bad as wars, like the Brexit or like Trump's election, what is crucial is to take this, I mean, think and use that in order to make a step forward. Two, the importance of democracy and all these deplorables who've voted the wrong way, right? Your colleague Josh Ober, who we mentioned before, sort of argued very convincingly that, in fact, one of the key virtues of democracy was to enable the decision makers to listen to the people, to gather all this information thanks to the elections and occasionally the referenda. It doesn't mean that the people who express these feelings have the right solution, but their feelings are real. And I think that all these votes and all the rise of populism is basically rooted in something that's fundamentally right, namely that the European Union has neglected them, has kept taking away all sorts of protection, things that protected them, let them be invaded by people with whom they couldn't communicate, let delocalize the firms where they had their local jobs. And this insecurity, social insecurity, cultural insecurity, needs to be addressed. And thanks to the election, thanks to the success of the populists, we know that we have to do something about it, and the quicker the better. Finally, pessimism. Optimism. I want to make you sort of, as a philosopher, to give you a personal advice, which is this: be pessimistic in the short term and optimistic in the long term. So predict and convince yourself that Trump will win, that Brexit will have a majority, that Van der Bellen will lose, and then in cases where what you predicted happened, you'll have the mediocre satisfaction of saying, you see, I was right. And on the other occasions, you'll have this nice surprise, like Van der Bellen being elected after all. That's how you can remain cheerful and keep your hope in this long-term success. So combine, so don't be pessimistic all the time, only for the short time, and don't be optimistic all the time, because then you'll be constantly disappointed.
That was a very nice closing note. So thank you, everyone. I think that the drinks are going to be next door, if I'm not mistaken. Thanks a lot. Very good exchange.